Okay, I'm kind of upset. For the last few weeks, I've watched a steady stream of iconic figures from entertainment and other media. People who, in big ways and small, were very much a part of my life and shaped me into the man you see before you, pass on to their just reward. People who, despite their advanced age and conditions, I could never fathom being without in my life. I know that they were still out there. To know that they were still out there, either in comfortable retirement or on the lecture or convention circuit, or in one case, still quite active as a major player on television, gave me hope that, in the words of Big Enos, old legends never die, they just lose weight. Well, let's just take a look at a small portion of this latest cascade of death among the rich and infamous. Dan Adkins, one of the great artists of the Silver Age of comics, active right up until a few months ago. His work graced the Marvel Age of comics, particularly Doctor Strange, the Silver Surfer, Conan the Barbarian, Captain Marvel. I refuse to call him, her, it, whatever, Captain Marvel. Warlock, Sergeant Fury, Nick Fury, Agent of S.H.I.E.L.D., and so many others. I die just a little bit every day when one of these fantastic masters of their craft, maybe not as well known as a Jack Kirby or a Neil Adams or a Frank Frazetta, leaves us in near obscurity. Also, Ray Harryhausen. Ray freaking Harryhausen. My best friend Michael is now in a deep state of mourning. The only thing I can do is hug my action figure Vemur just a little closer, which is kind of difficult because he's a little spiky. There you go. Okay, so here's my Ray Harryhausen story, and it's a great one. I met Ray along with a boatload of filmmakers and stars at the first Famous Monsters of Filmland magazine convention back in 1993, held in Crystal City near Washington, D.C. It was like the League of Extraordinary Geek Makers. Ray Bradbury, John Landis, the sons, daughters, and grandchildren of Karloff, Lugosi, and Cheney, Noel Neal, Lois Lane was there overseeing a cold reading of an episode of The Adventures of Superman, in which I got to play Perry White. I even got to wear a wig. She took the wig back, though. It was hair. I liked hair. I wanted hair. But she took it anyway. Anyway, the legendary Western hero and atomic monster combatant John Agar. But above all, Ray Harryhausen. The very first monster film I ever saw at the tender age of 7 was Earth vs. the Flying Saucers on Channel 4's Nightmare Theater. Now, a 7-year-old does not know that the destruction of Washington, D.C. was accomplished using small models and animating them just a fraction of an inch per frame of film. No, what a 7-year-old sees is a massive invasion of our nation's capital via flying saucers, the Washington Monument cut in half and crushing hundreds of visitors, and a huge saucer pile-driving into the Capitol building, effectively scaring said 7-year-old half out of his wits. Now, just a few years later, during a camping trip at a local recreational park, my brother Tim and I are watching Jason and the Argonauts on the CBS Saturday Night Movie on battery-powered TV, and we were nearly paralyzed with fright when the gargantuan statue of the giant guardian Telos suddenly moved. Whoa. Anyway, amidst all the wonderful guests... Oh, by the way, my bladder has never been the same since then. Anyway, amidst all the wonderful guests, there's Ray in the foyer, taking a break between panels and delightfully signing fan memorabilia in a completely non-scheduled autograph line. It was just that huggy bear kind of convention, the kind you just don't get to go to anymore. Unfortunately, I made a glaring mistake before I packed up to go on this trip. The one item I wanted Ray to sign, from the Land Beyond Beyond, a definitive filmography on both Ray and his mentor Willis O'Brien, I left the home. I could have just fed myself the guanji. Unfortunately, this was the summer, as a matter of fact, just 1 week later, when Jurassic Park would be in theaters all over the place. And if there was just one movie that could be said to have been influenced by the legacies of O'Brien and Harryhausen, well, earlier that day we made a tour of Crystal City's fantastic underground shopping mall, and the record store there had just stocked the Jurassic Park soundtrack on CD. I could only hope that Ray would take pity on a poor, forgetful boy. So I explained to him the situation. I told him all I had for him to sign was the JPCD. He smiled brightly in that warm, deep baritone voice of his. He said, "Sure, I'll go ahead and sign it, but if you show it to somebody, they'll think I did something in the movie, and I didn't do anything in the movie." "Sir, with all due respect, if it wasn't for you, there wouldn't be a movie." His smile broadened, and with all humility, he said, "That might be true." There have been others this year, lovely Annette Funicello, whose long ordeal with MS is finally at an end. We still like you, Annette. Our former governor, Otis Bowen. Frank Bank, who terrorized Beaver Cleaver and his pals as Lumpy Rutherford. Deanna Durbin. Oh, God, what a voice she had. And it sounds like she got out just the right time to live a full and private life. Finally, we come to Jean Cooper, the soap opera diva of divas. Yeah, in the history of daytime TV, there have been lots of evil rich broads, but Jean Cooper's Catherine Chancellor did it with class. Despite her drinking and killing her husband in a horrible car wreck, and the desperate measures she took to keep Joe Foster from getting her hooks into the Chancellor fortune, she always made me believe that she was the injured party. And when she finally let go of all those demons and finally became a true friend to the denizens of Genoa City, I truly felt such love for her. I credit both my wife and my mother for hooking me up to the CBS soap opera lineup. Wait a minute. Maybe I meant to curse him. Because up until then, the only soap opera I ever showed any interest in was Dark Shadows, for all the obvious reasons. But because Mom worked during the day, I had just graduated high school and was, for a time, a man of leisure, she asked me to watch As the World Turns for her. There I became caught up in the Dr. Dan Stewart, Kim Dixon, Dr. John Dixon triangle, with Dr. Dixon becoming to me the most hateful villain in soap operas. That eventually drew me into The Guiding Light, and finally, on my fiancé's request, The Young and the Restless. Nary an original cast member is on that show now. The original families, the Stewarts and the Fosters, they've been long gone. Only the character of Jill Foster is the sole holdover, and she's not even played by the original actress. Even Jean didn't begin her amazing 40-year run until 7 months after the series debuted in 1974. But during that time, through good times and bad, Catherine Chancellor was that serial's Rock of Gibraltar, where most soaps would start to freeze out their older actors in favor of the younger ones and relegate old-time favorites into barely supporting roles. Such was the popularity of Jean Cooper that she was always at the forefront in major storylines, and very much because she demanded it and got it. Case in point, the recent storyline where Catherine seemed to be suffering from the early stages of Alzheimer's. In an interview in Soap Opera Digest, Jean received her new script on the set and immediately approached the people I freely call her superiors and told them if their intention was to make Mrs. C a victim of Alzheimer's, then she was out of there. The writer scrambled to assure her that Kay's condition was not Alzheimer's. Whether that was in the works or it was something to placate the feisty Ms. Cooper, the end result was that Kay had a brain tumor, and she emerged from the operating room in absolute triumph. At this point, we have yet to see any additional scenes with Catherine past this last Friday. I know these shows on an average are shot a month and a half in advance, even more, rarely if ever in sequential order. But last week, Jill and Catherine had just finished an argument over Kay's decision to let her adopted son, Kane, run their company in favor of Jill. She got up from the chair, Jill offering to help but being casually waved off. As she headed for the stairs to go, Jill asked her if she needed any help getting up there to bed. Catherine looked at her with those tender, aged eyes and said, "I'll be fine. Good night, Jill." And she walked up the stairs, Jill slightly smiling. 2 days later, we got the news that she had been rushed to the hospital. If there was ever a parting goodbye scene. I don't think I'd want Catherine Chancellor to be my grandmother. But if I needed someone to have my back in a fight, by God, I sure would have liked that feisty old broad in there scrapping beside me. So, it's with this final word I leave you on.
Okay, you want a story? I'll give you a story. I'm addressing the entity to call it whatever he is, the plumber, pizza maker, spirit, entity, whatever, who calls himself Death. Okay, I know you're a coward. I'm not afraid of you. You've taken a lot of people from me and my family and my friends who have meant lots to us growing up over the last 40 years. And I've just decided you just gotta die, pal. I'll be there to collect the body. Oh, and on the off chance that you're a man, here's my address. Washington, D.C., the Capitol Building, House of Representatives. I'll be up on the big chair, up on the dais, overlooking everything. My name's John Boehner. I'll leave the floor open for you. Okay, you got your story?
Can't wait to watch the news tonight.